If there is anything we note about the message of Jesus, is that it disrupts mankind's religions.
We have plenty of examples of God's creative expression in the world, and the divine image is stamped upon us.
As an artist and Christian, I have developed a sort of unique or niche area of art.
I call you holy, your name is holy, you are so holy.
At the beginning of Jesus' ministry, we see how God disrupts man's approach to temple traditions and religion. The Israelites have been awaiting the arrival of a savior for generations, and one might expect their new king to be introduced with pomp and circumstance. Instead, John the Baptist, clothed in camel skin and eating bugs and honey, is God's choice to announce Jesus' arrival. In today's message, Brett McBride reminds us that God's ways are not our ways, and that God will reach people His way. This is Living Truth.
You can turn in your Bibles to Mark chapter 1. We're going to be starting a new series this morning. I drive downtown from time to time and oftentimes take the Don Valley Parkway. And as I'm driving down the Don Valley Parkway, I love the view of the city that you have before you when you come around the bend, see the Bloor exit, and you see the downtown core with the CN Tower sticking up. And I usually go down to Richmond Street for some meetings there. And when you get off at the exit, off the DVP, onto Richmond Street, and you hang right and keep to the right, there's a church there. It's called Riverside Church. Many of you, if you've driven downtown and taken that exit, you know what I'm talking about. Riverside Church has this sign that's been there for years that says, "Prepare to meet thy God." And I always wonder to myself, what's around the corner of this bend? Am I about to get into a horrific accident and meet my God? And depending on where I am in my walk with Christ and how well things are going, I read that sign differently. Sometimes it's very ominous and I'm going, "Prepare to meet thy God." Oh no. Other times when things are going well, it's like, "Prepare to meet thy God," and I can't wait to meet. As we look at Mark chapter 1, you could almost entitle it, "Prepare to meet thy God," because John the Baptist is sent to prepare the way for God's people to meet him in the person of Jesus Christ. We've spent the last number of months studying the book of Acts, and it really chronicles how the gospel goes into different regions and starts to impact cities and regions. And it describes how God disrupted our systems of religion. We find a couple weeks ago in Acts chapter 15, we looked at how the gospel disrupted the New Testament church's understanding of temple traditions and even the Torah itself. But when you study the book of Acts, you see whenever the gospel went into a city that was a pagan city or a Gentile city, the gospel would disrupt the temple traditions and religious understandings of every single region it went into. If there is anything we note about the message of Jesus, is that it disrupts mankind's religions. It changes them because he changes people. And we've spent time looking at the message of the gospel and how it's spread throughout the book of Acts. Now I want to spend some time over the next few months in the summer to look at how it all started and examine how did Jesus make disciples? How did Jesus go about discipling people? We will look at both his message and his methods. What were the lessons he taught his disciples? But equally important is to observe how he went about teaching them. In the Great Commission, he gives them the mission to go into all the world and make disciples, baptize them, teaching them to obey everything he had commanded them. It's important for us to remember that he doesn't tell them to teach them to know or believe everything he commanded them, although that's true. He says, teach them to obey everything I have commanded. So it begs the question, what are the hallmarks of Christ-centered community. What should a community of believers look like when Jesus is at the center of it? What values did he model for his disciples, and what does he wish to cultivate in our lives by his Holy Spirit at work within us? We will begin this journey by studying the first year and a half of Jesus' ministry. We are going to look at his ministry in a chronological order. So depending on when the event took place, we might be skipping throughout all the Gospels to get an understanding of what he's training within his early disciples in that first year and a half. And it all begins with God disrupting the normal patterns of his people's religion. In Mark chapter 1 and verse 1, we read this. The beginning of the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message. After me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you, I am well pleased." What I want to look at in our time together this morning is the cry of the prophet, the confession of the people, and the coming of the Christ. Luke also records this event that takes place, and in Luke chapter 3, verse 2, he states it this way, "During the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness." You have to understand, for thousands of years, the Israelites have been waiting for this moment that the Messiah would be sent to them. God had made it clear from Genesis chapter 3, as early as that event, right when sin entered man's condition, that he would send a deliverer, a savior. God had promised it through Moses. So for generations, the Israelites have been praying and waiting for this moment. Isaiah prophesied about it. Malachi prophesies about it. So throughout the Law and the Prophets, we've been waiting for this moment. In fact, during the time of Jesus, they would fast and pray twice a week so that the Messiah might come. And there has been a buildup to this moment. And when I read this passage, when I read the opening of Mark's gospel, what I find fascinating is that out of all the ways God could have heralded the coming of his kingdom, of all the ways that God could have introduced this King of Kings and Lord of Lords, he sends John the Baptist. A man who is wearing the latest fashion of camel hair clothing with a leather belt around his waist. He has not cut his hair or his beard his whole life. He's about 30 years old at this point, so he's got a lot of hair streaming down, wearing the latest camel coat clothing, eating bugs and honey. That is who God sends to usher in his kingdom. Now think about that, all of the pomp and circumstance that presidents, prime ministers, kings throughout the ages, all the pomp and circumstance that we build up, usually a king is introduced with a red carpet. Usually there's a dramatic procession before him. Usually he's dressed in royalty. Usually everybody, it's a black tie affair. What is God trying to say to his people, and what is God trying to say to us by how he introduces his King of Kings? Your ways are not my ways. What you value, all the pomp and circumstance, I don't value that. It's mysterious as you look at hundreds of years waiting for this moment, and God, even in how he ushers in his kingdom, is teaching us a lesson about humility. John was in fact the son of Zechariah, who was a priest at the temple in Jerusalem. John's mother herself descended from a priestly line. John was priestly royalty. He should have started his ministry in Jerusalem at the temple, a very respectable profession. He should have been wearing the fine linens and the beautiful priestly robes. It would have been a distinguished calling, but God's got a different plan for John the Baptist. The word of the Lord comes to John the Baptist, and it's not to go into Jerusalem where there would be these beautiful robes. He is to go out into the wilderness, and he is to preach a message. And as we look at the Judean wilderness, if you've been to Israel, it's just fascinating to me that strategically, I'm not sure any of us would have come up with the idea of sending a camel coat wearing, bug eating, honey eating prophet out into the middle of nowhere to reach the masses. Strategically, I wouldn't look at the region of Toronto and go, gee, I want to reach the region of Toronto. So what I'm going to do is put on a camel coat. I'm going to go out into the wilderness of Muskoka, and I'm going to start preaching a baptism of repentance. Again, God's ways are not our ways. And if there's anything we learn just from this passage alone, he doesn't need our strategic plans. He doesn't need our best thinking. All he needs is for us to listen, and when his word comes to us, to obey and do what he tells us to do. And he will reach his people his way. So the word of the Lord comes to John, and his message that he is given to prepare the way for the arrival of the Messiah is repent. It's the Greek word metanoia. Literally, it means have a change of mind. Have a change of mind that leads to a change in your path, leads to a change in your ways. Have a renewed understanding of your God and your position before him. He is preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Luke, again, in his account in Luke chapter 3 and verse 4, describes the ministry of John the Baptist with a quote from Isaiah chapter 40, where it says this, "A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked roads shall become straight, the rough ways smooth, and all people will see God's salvation." The word of the Lord has come to John the Baptist, and the word of the Lord is leveling the hearts of his people. Every valley filled in, every mountain and hill made low, every crooked path made straight, the rough ways made smooth. God's word is coming to his people, and it is leveling them. It is putting them all on the same plane before him, and he is, through repentance, directing a highway to their hearts. And repentance is the first order of business to prepare them for meeting the Messiah. And it's no different today. When God's at work in our lives, obviously, and oftentimes, it is in the area of bringing an awareness to ourselves of our position before him. Richard Lenski makes the following statement about the word of the Lord through John in this way. Such preparation is spiritual. It consists in the deep conviction and confession that you are unfit, a sinner, poor, damned, and miserable with all the works you are able to do. And we are told that as John the Baptist, dressed in his camel coat, eating locusts and honey, as he starts to deliver this message in the Jordan wilderness, we're told in verse 5, the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. That is a massive geographic region. And imagine all the people in Jerusalem, all the people in Jerusalem, leaving Jerusalem and making the long descent down into the Jordan Valley and going out into the middle of the wilderness because they hear that the word of the Lord has come to John the Baptist. There is a revival breaking out amongst God's people. And I've been to Jerusalem, and as you make that descent down into the Jordan Valley, you leave the lush gardens within Jerusalem, and as you descend down into this arid region, it's desolate, it's a wilderness, there's nothing growing there. And it seems to me that it might be the chief object lesson for the people coming from Jerusalem to realize their spiritual condition before God. That there's an aridness, a desolateness in our spiritual lives before God. And as John preaches this baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, who do you think is attracted to the message he brings if it is for the forgiveness of sins? Sinners. God is moving through power in John's ministry. People are coming out by the thousands, acknowledging their sin, openly confessing their sin. And these are God's covenant people. These aren't the Gentiles who are being called to repent. These are his religious people. These are the people who have the books of the law. They have the prophets. They have the temple. They have a whole religious system. And in order for them to meet their God, they needed to repent. Luke's gospel gives us a little insight into what John was explaining to the people. Now imagine this, in droves, people are coming out, they're confessing their sins, and then they ask John questions. What should we do? What does repentance look like in our lives? And Luke's gospel gives us a little information about the themes within John the Baptist's ministry. In Luke 3:10, it says this, "What should we do then?" the crowd asked. John answered, "Anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none, and anyone who has food should do the same." Even tax collectors came to be baptized. "Teacher," they asked, "what should we do?" "Don't collect any more than you are required to," he told them. Then some of the soldiers asked him, "And what should we do?" He replied, "Don't extort money and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay." As you look through John the Baptist's ministry, it strikes me that his message centered in on their positions, their possessions, and their power. You who have an abundance, share with others. You who have positions in commerce, tax collectors, be ethical, don't be greedy, be honest in your workplace. And you who have power in government, guard against corruption, don't extort, don't accuse people falsely, be content with what you have. The reason John is delivering a message of repentance for the forgiveness of sins to these religious people is because they had his word, but he was looking at their ways. And as he observed their ways, he sent his messenger to call them to repent. And as I studied this text this week, it made me ask the question, do I simply know his word, or are his ways evidenced in my life? Does my life, if someone looked at me from the outside, does my life embody his ways or simply a knowledge of his word? There's a difference. It reminds me of a church in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. Urban Promise, the ministry I served in before coming to the People's Church, actually started in Camden, New Jersey. Now, most cities have a ghetto. Camden is pretty much all a ghetto. It is a very, very difficult, dangerous city. It is oftentimes listed as one of the most dangerous cities in the USA. And this city faces immense challenges, and Urban Promise started in that city through Tony Campolo and a man named Bruce Main. And they started to reach out to children in the neighborhood, provide after-school programs, summer camps, things of that nature, all gospel-centered ministry to point people to Christ. And God started to transform lives. And he raised up a generation of young people who were growing in their relationship with Christ. Now, Camden is surrounded by some of the most wealthy communities in the United States. There's a real disparity in the income levels when you go from Camden, New Jersey, which is high-density poverty, and you literally go across a bridge, you are in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, which is one of the richest communities in America. And I've seen this myself. When you drive over the bridge from Camden into Cherry Hill, there are police cruisers that are stationed there. And if they notice that you're from Camden, New Jersey, they pull you over to ask you why you're coming into Cherry Hill. The racial tension between these two communities is palpable in the air. And God was moving in Camden, New Jersey, moving in so many of the young people's lives. And at the same time, Urban Promise was building relationships with churches that were passionate about the work they were doing, that would support what they were doing in the city. And there was one church in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, that became a key partner in Urban Promise's ministry. And they thought it would be a great move to take some of the young leaders that were emerging out of Camden and bring them to a spaghetti dinner for the youth group of this church, and that on a Friday night, they could gather together over dinner and get to know one another's stories and engage in some racial reconciliation to break down the divisions that existed with their two communities. And so the church planned a spaghetti dinner. The youth were invited out. They filled a bus with young leaders from Camden, New Jersey, and they journeyed across the bridge into Cherry Hill, and they drove to that church. Now, the old ladies of the church had cooked a beautiful spaghetti dinner. They're preparing this delicious meal, and the bus arrived with all the youth from Camden. They go into the church. They get ready for dinner. There was only one problem. None of the youth from the church had showed up for dinner. Not one of them wanted to eat a meal with a young person from Camden, New Jersey. See, the racial tension wasn't just out there, it was inside the church as well. And the old ladies who had worked hard to prepare this meal were embarrassed that their youth hadn't showed up. So they served the young men the spaghetti dinner, and they sat down and they broke bread with them, and they talked and they laughed and they shared one another's stories. And these youth were so fascinated with the stories of these ladies who had seen so much life experience. And there was this beautiful exchange of lessons, and it was a kingdom of God moment. And they were laughing, they were embracing, they were hugging, and the youth got back on the bus because it was time to go home, and they left, and friendships were made. It was a beautiful moment. As they were driving back through Cherry Hill over to Camden, their bus broke down. And within a couple minutes of the bus breaking down, a police cruiser had shown up and asked what was wrong and saw that it was a bus full of youth from Camden, New Jersey. And all of a sudden, four more cruisers showed up. The director of Urban Promise got out, talked to the police officer, and the police officer was very abrupt with him, and he said, "If you don't get this bus moving in 5 minutes, there's going to be a big problem." And the young men, seeing all the police cruisers come around, started to get very worked up because they've experienced some things in their lives. And tensions started to rise. Fortunately, one of the old ladies who had helped at the spaghetti dinner was driving home and happened to come across the bus that had broken down. And she pulled over when she saw that it was Bruce and the youth from the community. And the police, when she pulled over, kind of barricaded her from going near the bus. They said, "Ma'am, we've got this under control. Don't worry about it." And she kind of just pushed through them, walked up to Bruce and said, "What seems to be the matter?" And he goes, "I don't know what's wrong, but the bus won't start. I got to get out of here. Things are getting crazy." And she shouldered her way back through the police, went to her car, asked the police to move, and she backed her car up beside the bus. She pulled out some jumper cables from her car, attached them to her battery, attached them to the bus's battery, and sure enough, he fired the engine and it started up. And they drove away and everything was fine. It was a beautiful kingdom of God moment where God used someone to display to those in power that she was not only a person of his word, but she was also a person of his ways. But sadly, when you look at that story and you hear that story, that youth ministry, those youth who attend the ministry, certainly many of them would say, "I believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe that I am saved. I believe that I have a relationship with him." They could probably quote a lot of verses. They are people of his word. But the question that John the Baptist is asking the people of God is, are you people of his ways? We cannot just be people of his word. We cannot just be people who memorize this book. Although that's important for us, it also needs to be lived out in our daily interactions. God is preparing to meet with his people, and his message to his people is, you need to repent. You need to change your ways. And as I sat with this text this week, it made me look at my own life and ask the question, In what ways, Lord, have I been a person of your word but not of your ways? What do I need to repent of? What is that thing that I'm holding on to that gets in the way of what you want to do in my life? Be the question I have for every one of us this morning. Is there something in your life that is getting in the way of what Jesus wants to do? How have we, as a church community, been people of the word but not of your ways? Lord, where do we need to repent? What do you need to disrupt in our lives so that you can re-alter our ways? Oswald Smith wrote this of the church: people who are satisfied to meet together simply to have a good time amongst themselves are far away from God. And that's the danger for us, is we can gather together, and it's a beautiful thing to gather together, but if we're just looking to have a good time amongst ourselves, God looks at that after a while and just goes, it's not my heart, it's not my ways. We can gather around his word, but he's looking at our ways. Repentance isn't just a one-time event in our lives. Richard Lenski, in his commentary, writes this: the way must be prepared so that the Lord can come to us over it. But the work will always continue, since sins appear in us constantly. One preparation is not enough so that after that we may sit down and rest. The work goes on throughout life. When we put our faith in Jesus, we're delivered from the penalty of sin. That's salvation. But for the rest of our lives, we battle with the power of sin. And the Holy Spirit is given to us for our sanctification. But memorizing his word really doesn't matter if it's not evidenced in a repentant, changed life. I'm not saying memorizing his word isn't important, because it's absolutely necessary. But he's also looking at our ways. And sometimes we think that Bible knowledge is what it's all about. But the Great Commission says, teach them to obey, not teach them to know information. Teach them to obey. Because I dare say that each of us in this room would acknowledge that there's oftentimes a disconnect between what's in this book and our lives played out before us. And so in preparation for God to meet with his people, he has one message for them: repent for the forgiveness of your sins. And by coming out to the desert, the people who were confessing and getting baptized displayed that they had heard God's word and responded. They were people who hungered and thirsted for righteousness and wanted to be right with God. And they displayed humility before God by openly confessing their sins and being baptized. They confessed and they were forgiven. Now, if a revival like John the Baptist's was happening here in our region, if there was a wild man out in the Muskokas preaching a baptism of repentance, and the city of Toronto was driving up the 400 to go hear this prophet speak, if hundreds of thousands of people were being baptized, do you think Twitter would blow up? Do you think Facebook would have some live streaming covering it? Well, the same thing happens in the region of the Jordan in Jerusalem. All of Judea and Jerusalem are going, and as John the Baptist's ministry swells, the same thing happens. A revival is breaking out, and so the religious leaders, those who were in charge of the temple system that John actually was a part of and should have been working in, they send out an envoy to examine what is happening in the desert. And what surprises me is when you study the Gospels and see those who had devoted their lives to the study of Scripture, those who were experts in the law and their career was ministering before God, when they get out to John the Baptist in the desert, the word of the Lord has come to John and the message is repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. And those who had spent their whole life studying the word refused his message. It makes me ask, how is that possible? Those who should have been the most astute to what God was doing, because they had studied his word all their lives, The religious leaders, the experts in the law, the Pharisees, the temple elite, they reject his baptism of repentance. They look out over the scene and they see tax collectors and they see soldiers and they see all the underclass of society being baptized by John, and they stand there in their religious robes and they say, well, certainly they need to be baptized because they're sinners. But as for me, I'm good. I don't have sins to confess. How is that possible? How can you study the Bible and not obey the word of the Lord? How can you be a person of his word, but not a person of his ways? And it's a danger for us today, because as you study the Bible, you notice that people respond to the word of the Lord in one of two ways. It's either a posture of humility, acknowledging their need, or it's a posture of pride and resisting his truth. The word of God either makes you broken and contrite before him, or it hardens your heart. And it's a danger even for the believer today. We can hear his warnings and still harden our hearts. He can be putting his finger on something in our lives and we're refusing to repent. Every Friday night, we have family time together. We usually do pizza and a movie. It's a night that we all look forward to. Every Friday night, we make our own pizza, we eat it, and then we make some popcorn and go in the basement and watch family movie time. And I look forward to it every week. I love just being with my family, getting to watch a movie together, and have precious time with my two boys. And one Friday, we were getting ready for movie time. It was a movie we were all looking forward to seeing. It was one of those that the kids had been waiting for months to watch this movie. And so we're all excited. And one of my boys started misbehaving over dinner. And we're eating dinner, and he's really being rude to me. He's being rude to his mom. He's just misbehaving. And I warned him. I said, "You need to stop, son, because this isn't going to end well. If you keep this up, you're not going to get to watch the movie with the family." But he persisted in his disobedience. And I started pleading with him. I said, "Son, stop, take a moment, calm down. Listen to my voice, listen to me. I'm trying to help you here. I want to watch the movie with you. I want to be with you. I want to have our family time on the couch. But if you don't change your behavior, it's not going to end well. You're going to be sitting in your room and we're going to watch the movie without you. It's not that we're going to not watch the movie. We're going to watch it. You'll be in your room. Would you please just stop? I'm trying to help you. I love you. I want to be with you. But your behavior's got to change." Do you think he stopped? What's wrong with us? And he just persisted, and it's almost as though he got ruder, and I started to feel the wrath of God boil within me. Literally, the Holy Spirit descended on my table and said, "Yep, give it to him." And I was just so upset, I started to shake, and then judgment was pronounced. I slammed my hand on the table, and I said, "Go to your room. You're not watching the movie with us." He stomps off to his room. He's all upset. He's all disgruntled that he doesn't get to watch the movie. And I, to be honest with you, as a father, my heart was broken because I wanted to be with him. I wanted to have our family time. I get this once a week, really, where it's undistracted. And I was looking forward to our time together, and his behavior had created separation between us. Sure enough, we went into the basement, we started watching the movie, and quarter of the way through the movie, I went up to his room, and I said, "Son, what just happened?" And he's crying, and all he could talk about was not getting to watch the movie. He still wasn't repentant. He was more concerned about the consequences of his sin than remorse for his sin. And it struck me, how many times in my life has that been the case, where I'm more concerned about the consequences and not concerned about the actual sins I commit and the separation relationally it causes between me and God? And the Father is pleading, and the Father is saying, don't harden your hearts. Hear the word of the Lord. Repent. You've got to stop your behavior. You got to change your ways. And the Pharisees and the religious leaders are looking and just going, that's nice. The danger is when God's word comes to you to repent, it's one of two reactions: broken by his word and contrite before him, or hardened. And that hardness leads to a separation. We need to repent of our sin, and real repentance is about a change in our actions, not simply tears about the consequences. God is calling out to his people, but some refuse to acknowledge his word. Their pride blocks their ears. And repentance and confession are God's highway to our heart. Now, John's ministry, first and foremost, was to prepare the way for the meeting of the Messiah. But we learn in verse 7 that his message to the people was this: after me will come one more powerful than I, the thongs of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Think of the things that John the Baptist said of Jesus. He's more powerful. I'm not even worthy to stoop down and untie his sandal. I baptize you with water. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. John's whole ministry is about preparing the people to meet their God and about pointing to the Christ. And this is what's so profound about Mark chapter 1. Jesus, who has no sin, Jesus, who created every single person that's being baptized, all those who have gone out to confess their sins and be baptized by John in the Jordan for the forgiveness of sins, Jesus created every single one of them. Jesus, standing on the banks of the Jordan, staring at the multitudes being baptized, he knows every hair on their head. He knows every thought, every sin they've ever committed. And as the creator of the universe stands there on the banks of the Jordan, God's will is for him to stoop down and be baptized in a baptism that he was the only human ever created that didn't need to be baptized for the forgiveness of sins, because he hadn't committed any sins. Jesus, looking at his creation, willingly obeys the desires of the Father and gets baptized alongside sinners. What a beautiful name it is. That is the mystery of our God. He who has no sin identifies with those who are slaves to sin. Mark's gospel records what takes place, and it's worthy of our notice. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open. The Greek word for torn is the Greek word schizo. It means to divide by rending, to split into factions. It's like when you grab a sweater and you rip it. When Jesus is baptized alongside sinners, the heavens are torn open. The Spirit descends on him, and the voice proclaims, "This is my Son, whom I love, with whom I am well pleased." The heavens have invaded the earth. That word schizo is only used one other time in all of Mark's gospel, and it's at the very end of his gospel when Jesus is hanging on the cross and he cries out, "It is finished." The curtain in the temple is schizoed. It is torn in two. Our access to the Father is secured by his finished work. When Jesus gets baptized, the heavens are ripped open and the heavens invade the earth. When Jesus dies on the cross, the curtain to the temple is torn in two and our access to the Father is secured. Isn't that good news? What a wonderful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. If God's been speaking to you this morning, touching a place on your life and saying, "We need to deal with this. I know you're a person of my word, but you're not a person of my ways in this area." Just come before him and openly confess it. Because Jesus stands there, who was baptized alongside sinners, who went to the cross for sinners, and there is forgiveness of sins in his name. What a wonderful name it is. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you. How do we even say thank you? We who are so corrupt in our ways, we who need to repent, and in your mercy, you are baptized alongside us who need you. Your grace is amazing. And Lord, we ask your forgiveness. We declare openly and we confess that we have been people of your word, but your ways are far from us. And Lord, as a church, we ask that you would disrupt our religion, disrupt the routines that we settle into, and have your way in us. Shape our hearts according to your image, according to your likeness. And we declare together as a church, what a beautiful name. The name of Jesus, our Savior, our Christ, our King. Thank you for your amazing grace. In Jesus' name, amen.
God is always creative and often unconventional. He communicated through a donkey, talked to Moses through a burning bush, used a star to get a message to some wise men from the east, and announced the arrival of Jesus through a wilderness man. We have plenty of examples of God's creative expression in the world, and the divine image is stamped upon us. Creativity is in our DNA. We, like John, can point to Christ in unique ways and show the world the beauty of our God.
My name is James Ruddle, and I am an art teacher, a husband, father of three, and an artist. I am a Christian who is an artist, and I think it makes a difference being a Christian first, because everything in my life now draws people to and points people to who Jesus really is. And I think that can be done whether you're a musician, artist, athlete, teacher, lawyer, or anything. But I've just chosen to be an artist, and so I like to point to Jesus through all the art that I do. I think God has pointed me to the medium of art because of all of the experiences that I've had, all of the skills that I've developed through my life have allowed me to use my hands, to use my creative imagination, and to use the skill sets that I've developed over my life to show who Jesus is through the work that I create. As an artist and Christian, I have developed a sort of unique or niche area of art. I go around to different churches and I paint live in front of the band, and I help people to see God from a visual perspective. The music allows them to see how the Holy Spirit is moving, and I believe that through the act of painting, people are also drawn into worship, and that is the gift that I think God has given me. So there's a number of people in my life that have sort of challenged the perspective of art being an actual act of worship. And I would argue that God creates individuals to be creative. He's created people to have the desire to create. And so me creating visual images or visual interpretations of who I believe Jesus was is no different than a musician writing a song that also draws people to who Jesus was. I feel like the Holy Spirit sort of inspires an image or inspires a visual that I can at least draw upon. Sometimes it's a word, sometimes it's an actual image, but usually from that word or from that scripture, then I will sort of delve in and let the Holy Spirit sort of help me create something that is going to be impactful for the congregation, impactful for that message. I think from, you know, the world's perspective in 2018, we're bombarded by the image. And one thing in 2013 when I sort of met Christ was I felt like Christ was saying, you know what? You have been bombarded by negative images for so long. As a Christian artist, it is your time to start creating images that speak to me. Images that point to my son, and I feel like that sort of that prophetic word or that idea that God sort of gave me this idea to paint in churches has disrupted the norm of how a church service would run in North America. But I feel like that disruption also speaks so eloquently to people who have never seen it done before. And painting is totally different from music. You know, there is something that people can draw on. But overall, I would say based on feedback that people have given me over the years, it's been very, very positive. But I think the fact that God keeps opening up doors in the Christian realm continues to reaffirm the fact that I'm doing this for the right reasons. I have to continually check my pride, continually check my skill level and all of the things that make art good, and just sort of rest assured that God has given me this talent. God has helped me to refine my technique, to refine all that I have to point back to Jesus. Not all my work is Christian-based. I would say that I'm mostly inspired by the Group of Seven, and I have experienced God numerous times through our Canadian landscape. In 2014, I started writing a grant to get a bridge. It's called Henderson Bridge, and it's about 270 feet by 35 feet. I painted that in the summer of 2015 with six students as sort of my helpers. But the work that I am most proud of is the stuff that points to Jesus. And I feel like that's the most impactful thing that I've done in my life. I don't want to die having people remember my name, but I want people to at least see God moving through my life, through the body of work that I've created, and to see that there is this constant tie of bringing light into the darkness. So probably my favorite scripture that I draw a lot of inspiration from is John 12:32, and I, when I am lifted up, will draw all people towards myself. And that was Jesus saying that. And that refers specifically to when he is sort of prophetically telling people that he's gonna be dying on a cross. I draw so much inspiration from that because the cross, to me, is where I just fall on my knees in thankfulness, in understanding the reality of who Jesus was.
Attention, all passengers. This is the last call to purchase tickets for your Awaken 2018 trip to Israel.
Hello, I'd like to personally invite you to join Brett McBride and myself and the whole Living Truth team this fall on a journey to Israel, the land of the Bible. Awaken Israel 2018 will be a wonderful journey where the rich history and breathtaking landscapes of Israel offer context to both the Old and the New Testaments. We'll walk in places where Jesus walked and visit the sites where key events in Scripture took place. You can also look forward to delicious foods of the Holy Land, to great accommodations, and wonderful Christian fellowship. We'll also pause for a 2-day spiritual retreat on the Sea of Galilee, in which we'll look together into the Word of God and seek to make personal sense of the many things that we will have seen. I look forward to meeting many of you on this life-enriching and even life-changing journey. Do join us this November for Awaken Israel 2018.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith. Awaken Israel 2018 is an exploration of origin and destiny. Imagine your journey. From November 15th to the 25th, 2018, join Brett McBride, Charles Price, and the Living Truth family as we travel to Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, we'll visit Jerusalem, the Sea of Galilee, the Mount of the Beatitudes, the Dead Sea, as well as other amazing destinations. Ignite your faith through worship, heartfelt fellowship, and clear biblical teaching from Brett McBride.
For me, it's just been overwhelming to be here. And I know many of you feel the same.
Charles Price.
Many of you view Living Truth, which is why you came to come on this journey with us. And we're grateful that you did.
And special guests. During a 2-day seaside haven of reflection.
Traveling with the Living Truth is more personal and more endearing than I ever would have imagined. It's really nice to feel welcomed and to have commonalities with people that are of all different age groups. So I like that it's intergenerational, actually. It's quite nice.
The cost for this amazing Awaken Israel journey is $49.79. Don't miss out on reserving your spot now. Simply visit myawakenjourney.com or call 1-877-465-3442. Awaken Israel 2018. It's your time. The message of Jesus disrupted man-made religious understandings, traditions, and regulations because it changed people from within. Jesus turned the tables on religion. In this series, Disrupting Religion, Brett McBride examines Jesus' message, methods, how he taught disciples, and how the same disruption can apply to us today.
And it all begins with God disrupting the normal patterns of his people's religion. Does my life embody his ways or simply a knowledge of his word? There's a difference.
To order this series, call 1-416-222-3341, extension 289, or simply visit us online. God used John the Baptist to disrupt the normal patterns of the religious and usher in his new kingdom. A new kingdom with a new kind of king. One who was baptized alongside sinners and willingly died for our sins. Join us next time for more Living Truth.
To watch this message again, visit our website, download transcripts, order DVDs and CDs, as well as our daily devotional, or sign up for our monthly newsletter. Online, you can sign up for podcasts. You can also join us on Facebook and YouTube.
Join Brett McBride next week for more clear biblical teaching and a message called, What Do You Want? This is Living Truth.
Holy, your name is holy, holy you are.
calling.